All right, this video right here is for a friend of mine. She's like a sister to me. This video was for Holly. I told you I was going. Actually, I just got out of your live, so I couldn't wait to share this with you because I know how you roll. I know how you carry yourself. And then you know me from my past videos and the things I speak on. And I haven't shared some of my personal experiences in a long time because I kind of switched up my content. But I felt it was necessary to share this with you, and I want some feedback on it from you. So, and I'm going to just say this was a dream, but once again, I tell y'all, dreams are reality, but in a different realm. So, if you was to not wake from going to sleep, wherever you was at in that dream, that's where you are. That realm, that is exactly where you will be for eternity, all right? So I'm going to leave that one alone. But anyway, so all I know is I was on a college campus, and my college professor was, and I don't speak German, but he was German. But I understood every word he was saying to me. And all I kept saying to myself was, I got to get back to my classroom. I wanted to get back to my classroom. And I'm not a person that wants to go to college to further my education. I'm smart enough. I know there's always room for more education, but like I said, I'm smart enough. I got all the education I need, and I'm educating myself every day through life. But I was trying to find my classroom, and this professor said to me, "You're late." And I looked at him, and I said, okay, I'm trying to find my room. I'm trying to find my room. I don't want to be late. And it was this lady that was there. She looked like the lady that played in a James Bond movie. I forget her name. It was James Bond's professional friend, this older lady. And she looked like her. And I said, I need help. I need to get back to my classroom. The German professor said, "Oh my God, is it happening now?" But in German, but I understood it. And I immediately like took like alert to what he was saying. And for some strange reason, fear got into me just by the tone of his voice. And he said, "Now it's happening now. Well, we gotta go. We don't have time to alert the world." And I'm like, oh, wow, what is he talking about? Then all I seen was these people running through this campus. They were running. They were trying to get somewhere. And I said, okay, I'm not one to follow people because some people can lead you to your grave. But my gut told me to follow them. I wasn't even thinking about my classroom. I was thinking about getting a hat, some gloves, and my coat. I said, I gotta find my coat. I gotta get to my coat and my gloves. I'll never forget coming to this closet, and there was a set of, it wasn't a winter hat, but it was some red gloves, and it was a red coat, but they had black coloring on the coat. So they was red and black coat and gloves. And I don't know if it was the balcony, you know, the auditorium. I don't know if it was an auditorium with the balcony and the stage down bottom, but I remember the scene changing, and I was in this auditorium type area, and I was up high, and I'll never forget this person. They were like, "Oh my God, here it is!" And I looked to my right. I didn't want to look, but I looked to my right. And if y'all ever seen a movie, 2012, where what's the guy's name that played with Wesley Snipes? Woody Harrelson was on a mountain. It wasn't a mountain, but he was on that volcano, and I think it was Seattle. And the ground started to rumble, and it started to move like ocean waves. You know, like the ground was loose and ready to just boom. And it did. And when that person said, "Oh my God, look, here it comes," I looked to the right, y'all. I was in disbelief, like, uh-uh. And keep in mind, I've had similar dreams like this before, and I'll speak about some of them later. But I was trying to, like, sink all this in a matter of no seconds. Okay, this is coming, and it's coming like lightning. And it got closer, and I said, oh my God, this is really real. What am I going to do? There's nowhere to go. I jumped off the balcony. This balcony probably was about 20 feet. Didn't matter. I jumped off the balcony. But before I jumped off the balcony, I held my breath. I don't even think I said a prayer. I just held my breath and said, and basically said, F it. I jumped off. That fire, all of that went away. I was running down the road, and I ran into my uncle and my aunt. And they're not no longer together, but they were together in this realm. And I said, Unc, we got to get a car. We got to get a car. We got to get out of here. Like, now, there was this man who pulled up. He pulled up on this hill I grew up a block away from it. So he pulled up on this hill, and this is an actual street I grew up on years ago. Well, he pulled his car up, and I'm not even going to tell y'all who the man was, because y'all going to say, oh, this is really crazy, but this is actually true. And I'm going to just tell y'all. Sylvester Stallone, as silly as it sounds, he pulls up in a car facing downhill. And that was a sign of get in. My uncle looked at him, and I said, why did the car, in my mind, like, why did the car say police on it? And Sylvester Stallone was a cop sitting in his car. And I knew that was like a rescue to get us up out of there. But I told my uncle, no, we need a car. And my uncle, out of nowhere, had this gun, and he shot this man that was in a car. And he said, we got a car. I didn't even ask him why he did it. I was okay with it. And when I went to get in this man's car, me and my aunt got in that car. My uncle got in the car with Stallone. My uncle was no longer there. We were in an area. I think we was in the projects. I don't know what projects we was in. But I'll never forget a dumpster being there. And DMX, y'all know DMX is dead and gone. Well, not dead in my eyes. He moved on to better things. He was a good music artist. He was so on. Well, he was in this dream. And he was in this car telling somebody, when I tell you to give me the MFing keys and let me drive this MFing thing, I'm not playing with you. I really mean what I'm saying. And y'all know how DMX talks. Like, you owe. That's exactly how he was saying. He was like, and dude was like, he was ready to give up the keys and say, you could take my car. And I'm standing there like, really? This is DMX? And then another dude that was along with DMX in the music industry had said to him, oh my God, it's here. And I looked to the right, and I said to myself, there's no escape. The ground started buckling. Fire was everywhere. It was almost like the volcano just blew up out of the ground and just started coming towards us. So you ever see it? Basically, the first thing I seen when I told y'all when it started, I didn't say it, but you know how the sun sets over an ocean and it goes down, and then you see the sun, okay, go down. Just imagine the sun coming up 8 million times hotter than the sun, 8 million times brighter than the sun. That's what I saw every time they said, here it comes. And when it came closer, I jumped up out of the bed, heart beating. And just basically like, wow, one day. And I just pray one day, if I'm not to wake up to see another day. Not all of my dreams is bad, y'all. Don't get me wrong. Not all of them is bad. Some of them is signs and warnings and messages. I just pray that I don't wake up and not here, but I pray that I'm not there for eternity. Wherever I'm at, and it's bad, I don't want to be there. So, Holly, I want your opinion on my experience in that dream, and you tell me then. Like I said, I got some shocking stories I could tell you, and I know you heard them all. And as well as you remember the one where I told you about the chip in the arm, and I actually seen what was going on, and you know, we all call that chip in the arm, but I'm gonna leave that one alone. But you tell me what you think about that dream. I'm really waiting on your feedback. Love you. Stay blessed.